You noticed in the Jum'ah, in the khutbah today, I was trying to rush through these slides, but we're not doing them justice. So we'll just go slow and look at them carefully and also ask questions. Because in the khutbah, there isn't much chance for asking questions and ask for clarification. So we'll just go cover these slides very carefully. So if you want to start where you can see the screen. Okay, these are the ones that we saw so many times. Now when people go to the Christians and say Christ is not the Son of God, is the Messenger of God, they will accuse you of hating Jesus. When they're actually telling the truth. And the same is true with the Muslims. You go and say, you follow only the Quran, they may accuse you of making Muhammad, which is not true. When you say Jesus is a messenger of God, you're actually a friend of Jesus, and you're going to be with him in heaven. And the person who accuses you of hating Jesus, because you think that Jesus is Son of God or the Trinity or whatever, that person, Jesus will disown that person on the day of judgment. And that person will never be with Jesus in heaven. So don't let them tell you that you don't like Muhammad and you're against Muhammad because you're against Hadith. What happened is they fell in a trap where Satan told them Muhammad said this and that when he didn't. And the Quran says that the Hadith and Sunnah are fabricated by enemies of the Prophet. So that's why I was starting the first page by saying there's no salvation without obeying the messenger, because the messenger happens Quran. And you see this biblical instruction, when delivering God's messages, messengers do not speak on their own. Here is Moses in Deuteronomy saying, a prophet like me will belong to your God, raised up for you from among your own kinsmen, to him you shall listen. Now he's referring to Muhammad very clearly because it says, from among your own kinsmen. Now, some people may think that he's referring to Jesus. But Jesus came from among them, not from among their kinsmen. So coming from among their kinsmen, Muhammad came from Ishmael. But Jesus came from them, from the line of David. The next statement in Deuteronomy, God says, I will raise up for them a prophet like you, Moses, from among their kinsmen, and will put my words into his mouth. He shall tell them all that I command him. Listen to my word, which he speaks in my name, I myself will make him answer for it. So this is a very clear commandment to obey the messenger, even before, way before he was born. The Quran says obeying the messenger is obeying God. So obviously, the messenger is not God, he's uttered the words of God. And in the Gospel of John, we see Jesus saying, do not believe that I am in the Father, and the Father is in me. Now this statement is similar to obeying the messenger is obeying God, which we find in the Quran. In other words, if you obey me, you're obeying God. That's what Jesus said. When you obey me, you obey God. But it doesn't mean that he is God. What they abuse that statement. But the Father abiding in me does his works. For God puts his words through the mouth of the messenger. And this is why it was absolutely required that you obey them. In John 16:13, when he, the Spirit of truth, comes, he will guide you into all the truth. For he will not speak on his own initiative, but whatever he hears, he will speak, and he will disclose to you what is to come. And then we have verses saying that Muhammad does not speak on his own initiative. That's in Surah 53. Muhammad represented 100% by Quran alone. We sent down to you this book, truthfully, confirming all previous scriptures and superseding them. You shall judge among them according to what is sent down from God. It is defined as this book. And do not follow their wishes if they deviate from the truth. You shall judge among them, this is repetition now. You shall judge among them according to what is sent down from God, which is this book. Do not follow their wishes, and beware lest they divert you from that which is sent down to you from God, which is defined at the beginning as this book. Will they seek the laws of ignorance? Who is better than God as a lawmaker for those who sincerely believe? Now today I was trying to just bring into focus awareness of God and how He designed the moon and the earth, and how much did the human beings contribute to this, how much did Jesus contribute to the creation of the moon, or determining the speed of rotation of the earth. How much did Mary contribute to the creation of the stars? And it's just very simplistic and naive and downright stupid to draw for human coincidence. The problem of most people is the lack of awareness of God. They're walking around, driving down the streets, and they think of God as something abstract, you know, that but God runs the world like the chairman of the board. This person is fired, this person is hired, move this person, take that person, then nothing happens without God's permission and control. So you can see, I use the moon as an example. Did you see the moon tonight? See the two eyes, the mouth, and the nose, the face? Am I the only one who sees this? I see a very clear face. Yeah, so, I mean, you have to know that this is a deliberate design by God. Now, the reason we see the same side of the moon is that the rotation of the moon is very small. You know? The moon takes 28 and a half days to go around itself. 28 and a half, which is the length of time it goes from new moon to new moon. And it is going very slowly around itself, just going around the earth, like I showed you this afternoon. And the idea is to bring into focus awareness that God runs the world, that designs everything on purpose, everything by exact measure. The number of drops coming out in the rain is determined by God. The number of drops, even less than that. In Surah 10, God says, not an atom in the heavens of the earth is out of my control, absent from me. I'm forbidden from uttering any religious instructions other than Quran. And this is the verse where it says that the Quran is the utterance of an honorable messenger. It is not the utterance of a poet or a truth-sayer. It's a revelation from the Lord of the universe. And then it says, had we uttered any other religious utterances, we would have punished him severely. And none can protect Muhammad from God's punishment. This is in that verse. Therefore, the Prophet did not utter any religious instructions besides Quran. And this verse, Muhammad ordered never to deviate from Quran. Deviation meant severe punishment. I'll go a little faster than this because we've seen it before. This is the verse that speaks specifically about Quran, where they ask Muhammad to change the Quran and bring something else. And his order there to say, tell them I can't do that. I have to believe only the Quran. The rest of the verse talks about fabrication of lies and talks about intercession, by the way. See the last part down there? The guilty will never succeed. Yet they idolize beside God those who possess no power to harm them or benefit them, and say, you are our intercessors with God. Such is idol worship. And the myth of Muhammad the intercessor is quite prevalent in the Muslim world. One God, one source. This is a verse in Surah 6, verse 19. See the number of verse 19. It says that Muhammad brought the Quran and nothing else. And that if you go to other than Quran, then you're setting up another God besides God. So in your religious instructions, you fit only to Quran. You go to any other source, anybody, then you turn an idol worship. Then you're a big prophet. But if you stick to Quran, you're a very happy person. And you guarantee success and security and contentment, happiness and health and wealth and money. If you stick to Quran alone. So God values that. Another verse in Surah 17:39, that says, you don't set up any other God besides God, right? But go to any other source besides Quran. Quran is not a usual book. It's not like books of mathematics or physics or chemistry. Not everybody can read the Quran. If you have professors of Arabic linguistics, they will not understand the world unless they sincerely believe it. At the same time, we're told that God will put the Quran in the believer's heart, regardless of their language. So don't let anybody set you up that you don't know Arabic or this or that. Doesn't make any difference. When you're sincere, God puts the Quran in your heart. And I say this from experience. I met so many people, sincere believers, who don't know one letter of Arabic, but the whole Quran is in their heart. And they quote the Quran. You can keep that time from it. Yeah. Unless you want somebody to choose. Do you believe God or not? In this page, I have three verses. So the first one says, we didn't leave anything out of this book. The second one says, shall I seek other than God for wisdom when he sent down to you this book, fully detailed. And the last verse says, the word of the Lord is complete. When you tell them that the Quran is complete or not, they say, yes, the Quran is complete, but there's only but, if, or and. And I always tell them, I want you to answer me without if, and, or but. The consequences of not believing God are terrible. But they do not believe our revelations and are too arrogant to heed them. The gates of the sky never open for them. Nor will they ever enter paradise until the camel passes through the needle's eye. We will not require the boot. Thus, it is a physical impossibility for those who refuse to believe God to enter paradise. The Quran is a great blessing or a terrible curse. They don't believe it and follow it. But the blessing is just unimaginable. Important criterion of divine revelation. If they tell you Hadith is a divine revelation, tell them they don't know what they're talking about. Because the criterion is complete preservation. The blessing is evident when they claim that Hadith and Sunnah are divine revelation. Do they not realize that God Almighty is capable of preserving His revelation? It's a blasphemy to say that Hadith and Sunnah are divine revelation. So they're accusing God of being unable to protect or keep it. And we're familiar with the big verses in the middle, but the one at the bottom says they insist upon following conjecture when the guidance is given to them herein from the Lord. You remember the definition of Quran at the beginning of Surah number 2 is defined as Huda, guidance. And this is exactly the word used here. We have physical proof that Quran is from God, but they don't have any shred of evidence that the Hadith was even uttered by Muhammad. Obeying the messenger's condition, this is the one where he's told that they do not disobey you when you arrive. This is the verse that says, if anything good happens to you, it is from God. And if anything bad happens to you, O Muhammad, this is specifically for Muhammad. If anything bad happens to you, it is from you.
Oh, good.
Yeah, because the summer. Yeah, because I don't know how much of it you want to read. So the personal opinion of Muhammad may be bad and may cause bad things to him. On the other hand, Muhammad, the messenger, utters the word of God that is the Quran and must be obeyed absolutely. But whoever obeys the messenger is obeying God. And we have to obey the commandments of God, not the commandments of men. This is the verse where Muhammad's adopted son divorced his wife. And Muhammad was ordered to marry the divorced wife of his adopted son in order to establish a precedent. It's perfectly right for a man to marry the divorced wife of his adopted son, not his adopted son. But the Prophet Muhammad didn't want to do it because it was contrary to the traditions of Arabia at the time. He was afraid of the people instead of fearing God. And this is the famous surah entitled, We Crown. I don't think God would want us to neglect the poor person because he's poor, or give our attention to the rich person because he's rich. That is not a behavior to be imitated. And I don't think the Prophet will want us to do that either. So this is the Quranic proof that we are not to follow the Sunnah. Sunnah means imitation of the Prophet. This surah simply rules out the business of Hadith and Sunnah as sources of religious instruction. Muhammad. This is the verse where Muhammad is described as a human being like you. And like you is repeated in the other verse. Like you, a human being like you. You can be right and you can be wrong. Muhammad can be right, you can be wrong. You are not really a complete devoted believer unless you realize that you can be equal to or better than Muhammad or Jesus or Moses or anybody or all human beings like you. And you are capable of being like them or better than them. Or capable like this to make their hair stand up. This is how it's either wrong. You just don't think they can be equal to or better than Muhammad or Moses or Jesus. But any human being can be equal to them or better than them. Surah 4, there's a verse in Surah 4 that says, if you simply follow what God says, you're going to be with the author of means equal to them. This is the other verse that says, Muhammad is a human being like you. And both verses end by saying, do not fall in either word. Tomorrow, I'll give you a copy of the book that we're being copied today.
Yeah, you're in the
book. Well, just copies. Yeah. Okay, abuse of Quran. This verse says God and His angels make salat on the Prophet. Now, I put the translation right there, encourage the Prophet. All you who believe, you too shall encourage him and support him completely. This is about the most abused verse in Quran because they have at least 100 hadiths that say you say, Allahumma salli ala Muhammad 1,000 times a day for I don't know how long, you guarantee it. Yeah, you guaranteed him. You never go to hell, so you can do anything you want after that. You can quit your prayer. And you don't have to fast or nothing.
You
get a prophet because you want to
time.
Yeah. And they do it. People do it. And then don't want to guarantee him. Now, at the bottom of the page is the verse that says that God and His angels do exactly the same thing for every single believer, not just the prophet. So, they take that one out of context. And it is used all over the Muslim world to praise the glory of Muhammad day and night. Literally. Right after the morning prayer and after the night prayer. every day. They do a few hundred of those. And we get different books called the Rood Sharif. They'll give you all different forms of Salat on the Prophet. And at the end of the book they say, if you make 100 copies of this book and distribute it to 100 friends, they do it like a chain letter. That's why we keep getting them in the mail. They go straight to the payment court. This verse here is also a beauty. And the Prophet, the Messenger of God, is a good example for you. And we say, of course he's a good example for us. His example is to follow the Quran. And nothing but Quran, that's his example. Now the same words are applied to Ibrahim, word for word.
Not all type of Musa.
No, but not word for word.
But this is a difference, because Moses also can read it sometimes.
Right. But I took that verse at the bottom of the page because, as far as Ibrahim is concerned, the very same words are used for Ibrahim, but they don't mention Ibrahim. They apply to only to Muhammad. Would God hate Muhammad? Of course not. But when you repeat the same thing that God says about Muhammad in Quran, they accuse you of hating Muhammad. I remember a standoff that I had with a friend of mine in Libya, where I told him, did the Prophet frown and turn away from the poor man and give his attention to the rich man or not? And he wouldn't answer me. They just refused to acknowledge that so. And he stood there for a half hour waiting for him to answer me. Did he frown or not? So when you say the same thing that God says about Muhammad, they say that you hate Muhammad, you're a hater of the Prophet. Muhammad cannot guide anyone. This verse in Surah 28 says, you Muhammad cannot guide even the ones you love. God is the one who guides whomever he wills. And this makes sense because God knows the deep convictions of everything of anyone, and he knows who is worthy of guidance and who is not. The true love of Muhammad, the true love of Jesus is to recognize him as a human being and the messenger of God. The Christians love Jesus so much, yet he will disown them on the day of judgment. The true love of Muhammad is to recognize him as a human and to follow his teachings, that is, uphold Quran, nothing but Quran. Those who follow Hadith and Sunnah are named as Muhammad's enemies, and Muhammad will disown them on the day of judgment. So, the Muslims are nothing smarter than the Christians. Why should they be? They're all human beings. This verse refers to the Day of Judgment. On the Day of Judgment, the Messenger Muhammad will say, my Lord, my people have deserted this Quran. We thus set up against every Prophet's enemy from among the guilty. Your Lord suffices as a guide and support. Please note the word for word similarity between verse 31 above and verse 112 of Surah 6, where it says, you set up enemies of every prophet to talk the same fancy word to mislead the people. God is the one who created you, God is the one who provides for you, God is the one who terminates your life, God is the one who resurrects you, God is the one who calls you to account. Muhammad does none of these things. That's in Surah 30. Say, O Muhammad, I do not bring anything new that is different from any other messenger. I have no idea what will happen to me or to you. I simply follow what is revealed to me. I am no more than a manifest warner. The next verse says, say, O Muhammad, I possess no power to benefit or harm even myself, except in accordance with God's will. Nor do I know the future. Had I known the future, I would have increased my wealth and no harm would have afflicted me. I am no more than a warner, as well as bearer of good news for those who believe. Yet, we're going to see the hadith in the next page. Muhammad does not know the future, yet hundreds of hadiths narrate future events that have nothing to do with Quran and represent personal predictions. One of the most prominent hadiths is shown below. This is the hadith of established Sunnah. Hold on to the sunnah, my sunnah and the sunnah of They indicted Khalifas after me. Yeah, that doesn't count me.
Yeah, you see.
I oppose that. As you can tell. Now, the expression, the guide of Khalifa, was not used until 100 years after the Prophet had died. It doesn't take much intelligence to realize that this hadith is false. And it could not have been said by the Prophet, because first of all, how did he know he would have successors after him? And how did he know that they would be called Khulafa' Rashidin, the guide of Khalifa?